Welcome to the seventh gathering of the Adventure Party on this, the 9th of May. I'm your party leader, Brad Ludwig. We ask that you peace tie your swords, holster your blasters, and don't hand over your cred stick until the run is complete while you're gathered at the meeting table. The second in command here, as always, is Glenn Bittner, and he is the creator of the RPG Mistrunner. How are you this evening?
I am wonderful!
I was waiting for you to break into show tunes or something, a little Music Man or a little Oklahoma.
Wait till my news segment, and then it'll be nothing but singing.
I enjoy the South Pacific, so if I can make a request, sir. Bally High, South Pacific. All right, moving on. Our guest this evening is Pat Rothfuss. He is the New York Times best-selling author of the Kingkiller Chronicles. His books, The Name of the Wind, The Wise Man's Fear, and The Slow Regard of Silent Things are definitely great reads and have a very well-built world in which these stories play out. His charity, World Builders, has been fundraising since 2008 for Heifer International and has raised over $3.5 million for that benefit. This has been done through auctions and folks purchasing items related to the world that he has constructed through the Tinkers Pax online store. And this meeting of the Adventure Party, we wanted to talk to Patrick about his world-building skill and what it takes to construct a well-thought-out world that is very robust and fun to play with and to re-experience game session after game session, or in the case of Pat's books, to visit those in written form. And the one thing that I'm going to gush for just a second, Pat, the one thing that I've really appreciated about your books is... Okay, I'm gonna compare something here, and people are probably not going to like this. I can't get through Dune. I get to the part in the book where Paul Atreides has been asked to put his hand in the pain box, and I really don't think that Herbert needs 5 pages to talk about that damn pain box. It's a very important moment, but he needed an editor, and there needed to be brevity. And the thing that I enjoy about your work is that through efficiency and economy of words, you construct a very robust picture of your world, and you don't need 20 pages to talk about the look of the bridge that Quoth is walking over as he's walking to devise, you know, the place of business to strike another deal to get a loan. I mean...
Well, I mean, to be fair, some of it's an issue of flavor. You know, I mean, first off, that's, you know, I mean... Dune is one of the very first books that I ever didn't make it all the way through.
Oh, thank God I'm not alone. Okay.
No, you're absolutely not alone there. Glenn, have you ever done Dune?
Yes.
No, I will say, like, I've read it later, and it's it's a masterful frickin' book, you know? And it is also, like, a masterful... like, above and beyond masterful example of world building. And, like, a truly rare example, especially considering when it was written, of, like, drawing on non-Western cultures.
Sure.
Now, that said, he's got a little bit of the Tolkien thing going on, where there's a certain amount of description of springy turf happening and stuff like that. Which, you know, and I've read Tolkien, and I love Tolkien too, but it's a different philosophy. And the truth is, I go on and on a bit too. It's just that for some people, the ways in which I go on and on are a little more palatable.
Yeah, I'll give you that. I'll give you that.
And you know, should we play this straight, like a straight interview, or can we fess up to the fact that we know each other? Because otherwise. You know, like, you know, some of the things that get said in this interview,
yeah,
people might be like, wow, it seems like that's a really inappropriate thing to say to somebody who's interviewing you on the radio. should we cop to the fact that we all have known each other for...
Well over a decade. 15 plus years, yeah.
Yeah.
I was trying to be professional and just try to, you know, hey, let's do an interview. But yeah, we've been together for a bit now. We'll fess up to that. But you're right, because people probably would have scratched their head and went, really? They can say that to the Pat? What's going on?
No. We should all be totally cards up, especially because, you know, cards on the table, rather, just because, I do some of these interviews just because it's like, I should, or, oh, I can help promote something. But I'm doing this one because, I've seen some of the ones that you've done. I saw, you know, you had the one with Ian on there where you talked about some cool stuff. And I'm terribly fond of you guys. It's like, and so I'm saying that to my people that might have showed up here. It's like, I'm doing this not, you know, just as a promo stunt or because a publisher set it up or something. It's like, because these guys are my friends, and you should assume that my friends are, like, legitimately cool folks who know what the hell they're talking about. And when it comes to games... Well, acquainted.
The reasons that I wanted to get you on the show is because I know for a fact, and I had the good fortune to actually be in one of those sessions where you actually play tested your world a little bit. And
you say good fortune. I can't remember which one was it, because there have been some real train wrecks.
I was in the one. It was a very late night session. It was, I think it was one of Sarah's probably first times gaming, and it was myself, Sarah, Dale, and there was somebody else, and I remember Ian. Playing a. I think it was Ian. And I remember I was playing a jester character, and we were traveling on the road to go somewhere, and I can't remember where. And that's one of the things that I really wanted to talk to you about, is in that economy of words, in how you've constructed everything, I think people should really know that not only is your wordsmithing skill part of what made such a wonderful book, but you actually took the time and care. I mean, people don't really realize that you had this huge chalkboard where you actually mapped out the economy, you know, what currency equals what. And when I say chalkboard, you know, ladies and gentlemen, this chalkboard was at least 10 to 12 feet wide. I'm assuming that you still have it in your house.
Yeah.
And it's at least, what, 4 or 5 feet tall? I mean, it's a monster.
It's an old classroom chalkboard, yeah.
And you mapped everything out so wonderfully, and then taking the time to actually playtest the world. And I wanted to talk to you about that, because when I think of authors and their ties to gaming, the only thing that I can think of is Wild Cards, the Wild Cards anthology series, which started from a group of people that played this world where people are, and if people listening to this haven't read Wild Cards, please do. And it's a world of superheroes where an alien race drops this bomb, this payload, and it gives people powers. And there are some people who have abilities but are very deformed. Like there's a woman who has, like, her skin is invisible. And there are some people who have abilities, and one of the main characters that they follow in the first book has the ability to teleport. And he looks like a regular everyday Joe, and he's investigating something that's happened in the world. But that said, that's the only thing that I can think of that involves gaming off the top of my head, and you might know of more, but
blower for me, because I know about Wild Cards, but I did not know that was originally based on a gaming thing.
Yeah, it was. And it...
Does that mean Martin was a gamer? I mean, I'm not surprised if he was, but...
That I don't know.
That's Martin's baby, isn't it?
Maybe?
Because he was one of the prime movers of Wild Cards. He's like the head editor of the series, from what I understand.
Okay.
Or I might be a little misinformed there. I know about that from I know that it's an example of a rare creature, which is a shared world, where many authors would come in and from, and this is imperfect, I would need to research this to confirm these facts, but from what I understood, they had a very cool, progressive way of like handling, because normally if you write something for an anthology, they give you some money and maybe you get a piece of the royalties on the back end. But with that series, if somebody created, if I wrote a story and it had a character in it, you would effectively get shares of the world. Mm-hmm. And then later, if you wrote a story, you would get a certain number of shares in the world. But if you used my character, you owed me a share of your story. And so it was a really cool, collective, collaborative thing, but I had no idea that it was based in gaming.
Yeah, and this is from Wikipedia. Now, granted, Wikipedia has, but I remember reading this in a foreword. Many of the original authors were also inspired by a long-running Albuquerque, New Mexico campaign of the role-playing game Superworld, game mastered by George R.R. Martin, and many modeled their characters on their in-game persona.
That is super awesome.
So Martin's been holding out on you, buddy.
Like I said, I'm not surprised, but I mean, all of the stuff that he's done, he does a lot of stuff, and he's involved in some video games and HBO, and he's done Hollywood. Like I said, I'm not surprised that he's a gamer from way back. But I just did not know. It warms my heart to know that he's one of us in yet another way.
But, that said, the purpose of what they did wasn't necessarily to playtest the world and to, construct playtest, as it were, and get a different sense of... I'm going to make an assumption here. As an author, the things that you do are more in your head, and it seems like doing this as an RPG, to actually play the world, is to kind of have an opportunity to get outside of your head and to let other people experience it and maybe get a little bit of feedback and see some of the mechanics in actual, instead of theory, in practice. So, or am I glorifying it and it was just something else different?
No, I definitely think that can happen. I know, I think whenever, and I know, I'm kind of curious what Glenn's take on this will be, because I know you play test too, but because you did your own system, mm-hmm. And you have your own world for that, and I know sometimes I play tested things in order to, you take the system out for a drive and you're like, how can I twist this and break it, how sturdy is it, and then there's the world sometimes. But testing out the world is very different. And for me, sometimes it's more of an issue. I had a cool idea and I wanted to run it through its traces, or I had something I thought was a cool idea and then I spring it on people and they just could not. Can we cuss here?
Yeah, go ahead.
Sometimes I bring something out of this is going to be awesome, and people could not give less of a shit. For you, Glenn, when you were testing out your world, how much of it was influenced like that, where you threw some stuff up and you saw what people would get really excited about?
Quite a bit. There's that part of me where it's I was actually talking about something like this at work today, where there's those, almost anything you read, whether it's a book or even a movie you watch or a game you play, you come across that thing where if you've done a lot of the world building type stuff, you come across something where you feel kind of meh about it, but that little thing in your head goes, the person who came up with this probably thought this was the coolest fucking thing ever. And that's how I felt sometimes in the playtest, where this part here, man. Of all the things I created, this little bit right here, this one's really cool. And I'll drop it and then just be like, it's like I just said nothing. It's like there's just vacant looks, nothing happened. I'm like, really? That was, I mean, come on with the, and I did the, you missed all the, how? Okay, moving on. So yeah, but I mean, but there's also that amazing feeling when people, you know, when you can see that look of awe when you drop something on them, if you're like, wow, that's awesome. And then you're like, okay, I did something right. Hooray.
Yeah, right. Right. And it is, you know, I think in gaming, because I use a lot of beta readers. You guys have both been beta readers for my books as well.
Yes.
But that is, it's very different having a beta reader because the interaction can be dynamic. Like, I give you the book, and then you write stuff on the book, and then I ask you questions about it, and you answer them, and I ask follow-up questions. But that's still fairly static. You know, it's like you're experiencing a manuscript, you know, as opposed to something that is truly, truly interactive. I don't want to say dynamic, because, you know, is static or dynamic. A book can be dynamic as well, but, like, when you're sitting down at the table with somebody, that is truly, that's a fluid situation. That is an interactive thing. And it's an entirely different sort of, I don't want to say energy, it's an entirely different experience. And honestly, a lot of times I can see how people feel about parts of the book as a beta reader, and that's good. That's what I want. But what's more interesting for me when I game is, like, when I bring something out and I'm like, so here it is. Here's this thing. And then they're like, okay, you know, and maybe it's like a creature I had an idea for, the Dracus. You know, lived in my world long, long, long before it ever showed up in the book, and long before I ever considered putting it in the book. I made that specifically for the game and for the world, but I knew I never wanted to have a dragon in the book because that was really some cliche bullshit. Yeah. And so I put it in, and I would usually, that was always one of my default you know, things. It's like, if I needed a little action to spice things up, what would happen is, you know, they'd be camping at night, and they have a campfire, and they have chosen their watches, and then this thing, like, charges in from the shadows and starts, like, breathing fire and rolling around in the campfire, and suddenly it's dark, and there's this thing, and everyone's like, oh, shit, we're being attacked. But it doesn't give a shit about you, you know? It's actually just there to, like, roll in the fire, I must use that two or three times before I ever considered bringing it in as a plot element in the first book.
All right. I want to table this just for a little bit. I want to get in a little bit of news, and then I want to come back to the actual interview because this is like the first time that we've just charged right into the interview, but it was just kind of an organic. No. It was an organic thing. It was an offshoot. I mentioned wild cards, and we were off to the races. So we're just going to go into the news just a little bit here. There's just a couple of stories that kind of caught Glenn in my eye this week, and then we're going to kind of move back into things here. So Glenn, why don't you take the first story, and we'll roundtable it.
All right, so if I haven't made it clear in some of the other podcasts we've done on here, and for those few people that I talk to in person, my other friends, I have like two or three, you'll know that I have a bit of a gamer chubby for the new 5th edition D&D. And I was just at a trade show, AC Distribution's open house, and I was at the D&D seminar that they gave, talking about some of the stuff that's coming up, and they had announced the new adventure path they have coming up. It's Rage of the Demons, and the first book coming out is Out of the Abyss. Now, one of my favorite settings, I like all settings because I like worlds and I like stealing stuff and adapting to my own use, was the whole concept of the Underdark. Love the Underdark. And they're taking that, and they're actually they're changing a bit, and they're actually making it a place that makes sense for creatures to live. Instead of just being, you know, these soulless, you know, endless series of caves and caves and caves, well, why would anything live there on purpose, aside from, like, you know, some blind cave fish and maybe some bugs? So they're making it more of an actual, like, world where there's, like, you know, you've got, like, this glorious, you know, mushroom forest where the Myconids hang out, and of course you have Menzoberranzan where all the drow are. And then, you know, because it's D&D and you want to have some kind of conflict, it can't all be, you know, underground butterflies and, you know, cave puppies. It's got to be something else, so...
I would play that game.
Yes. All right, so that's my next game I'm working on. So, of course, you have some dude in Menzoberranzan who says, I'm going to summon a demon, you know, and bend them to my will. And he summons, they go old school, and he summons Demoborgon. So they're going back to the old school, first edition demons are popping up, and it kind of like rips a hole into the abyss, and like all these old school demons come popping into the Underdark. So you've got Demogorgon pops up in Menzoberranzan, and it takes Loth herself to expel him. You've got Orcus, the Prince of the Undead, ends up like in a Mind Flayer hive, and now you've got undead Mind Flayers roaming around doing his bidding. You've got Jublix, the god, you know, the kind of god of oozes and slimes. And then you've got all the different characters they're introducing that'll interact with the players. One of them is Jublix makes a gelatinous cube sentient.
What?
A sentient gelatinous cube. So it sounds like some really interesting stuff that you're doing. I mean, one, I like the fact, because I remember, I'm old enough, I remember, you know, the whole satanic panic of the 80s, and there was that time when they removed all the demons and devils from D&D. They just, it's like, that didn't happen. It was kind of like, you know, it was kind of like how everyone else in the world treats Highlander 2. That never happened. So, I'm glad to see them, you know, going back to the fact that, you know, it's like, yes, there are demons, there are devils, there are these bad, evil creatures. And they're, you know, they're throwing them into the Underdark. And it's fun because this is you start as level one characters. And I like how the guy was describing, it's like, you know, hey, we're level one, you know, we're looking for some kobolds to kill. And then I see, you know, it's like, ow, what's that pain in my neck? And then you wake up in a drow prison cell. And that's kind of, and then it like happens from there. It's all these demons and stuff. So I'm looking forward to it. I am not one who generally plays the prepackaged adventures. I like coming with my own stuff, or maybe just taking an idea for something and then just going, okay, this sounds cool, and then just going with it and making it end up being completely different. This is something I might actually want to run and play with people. Yeah. Because it hits on a lot. I mean, I remember the old school demons, and I remember killing off many, many players with all of these big badasses from the old books. And the other thing I loved was, now, as much as I love old school D&D, because it's, you know, this is what got me started down this whole path of games and gaming, the art, now, mind you, better than anything I could do, but the art back then is primitive.
Yeah.
And seeing where they show up, you know, here's you know, this, you know, junior level art class of high school picture of here's Demogorgon, and then they show the new one, you know, the full color. It's like seeing that difference. It also kind of shows how the game has grown over the years as well, and how it's changed and everything. So I'm really looking forward to this one.
Yeah, the more I hear about 5th edition, the more impressed I am with it, because 4th edition was just despised horribly. And now, if I'm not mistaken, Green Ronin worked with Will Wheaton, didn't they, to make the system that he's using for his tabletop.
I don't think I mentioned that this is Green Ronin partnering with Wizards of the Coast.
Yeah, okay. Well, I noticed that in the story, and I went, yeah, okay.
One of the great stories I just heard recently, I was at C2E2, and I interviewed Jim Butcher, and pretty much all we talked about was gaming. because he's, like, dyed in the wool, you know, started with AD&D. Sounded like he was a little more AD&D. I I really planted my feet firmly in second edition.
Yeah, me too.
He was one of the playtesters for fourth edition. And so he's like, all right, I'm flattered. Let's go in. Let's do it. And so he went in, and he said he gave it a two-word review and sent it back. And he said, new Coke. it's just excoriating and horrifyingly true. Now, I'm not saying that 4th edition was a bad game. I think it was actually a great game, but I don't think it was good D&D.
Yep.
Okay.
And I will say, having played 5th, and never even playing much of 3rd, 5th is so nice. It is so nice. And the people at the helm right now, taking care of these story elements, Chris Perkins is one of the people who's like really got his hands in it. They are smart. They are smart, and they, it is in good hands, and the more they let those people control what's really happening, and they don't make any new Coke decisions, when I made a 5th edition character, I'm like, wow, elegant yet flexible. This is the best D&D I have ever touched.
Okay. Well, see, now with those glowing reviews, I keep hearing wonderful things about it. The gaming group that I'm with on Monday nights, we play Pathfinder, which is essentially D&D 3.5.
Yep.
That's pretty sweet. I enjoy that. It would be interesting to run a 5th edition just to kind of compare and contrast between those, just to see how far they've come and the different levels of flexibility that you have with this new system. That would be fun to do.
It is, and speaking as somebody who has played a fair number of systems, you know, including, you know, I don't know if I can truly say that I've done the whole spectrum, because on this end of the spectrum is Traveler, you know, which is like, you know, it's like, get your degree in particle physics and advanced quantum mathematics, and then let's create your character. And then all the way over here is effectively Mind's Eye Theater LARP rules, where you're playing paper, scissors, stone for everything, right?
Yep.
Or you could probably go even farther there, but I don't know what I would put on that other end of the simplicity bell curve in terms of, like, learning a system, you know? Like, Teenagers from Outer Space, or
Macho Women with Guns.
Macho, you know, like, one of those, like, really, like, sit down and play it drunk over pretzels. You know, that sort of a...
Sure.
That sort of a system. You know, it's... I'm not afraid, but I've played Champions. I did Champions, and that's what I ran all of my world in, because it's so eminently flexible. And now you notice I say eminently flexible, not elegantly flexible. It is perfectly solid. It's like this beautiful mathematical ecosystem in Champions, and you could do anything, and it's so tight, and it's like the Cadillac of role playing, but it's work, you know. It's kind of like a job, and I didn't mind having that job back in the day, but I always despaired of bringing people into the system. It's because it was like saying, okay, I'm going to need you to, like, put in about 15 hours of work before you can really start enjoying this experience. whereas this new D&D, you know, you could sit down and make a character and get the system and... You know, I mean, but then again, I came in the THACO days, you know, where you really had to do mental gymnastics to figure out, like, who was going to hit who.
Yep.
Sorry, whom. but yeah, you know, I know, I very, wouldn't you agree with me, Glenn? It is, it's so. Have you been playing it or just eyeballing it?
I've run it. I haven't played it yet, and I want to really play it. But I mean, I've run it several times, 5-6 times at least already. So yeah, it is a giant step from the old Thaco days.
Yeah, and now do people pick it up pretty easy?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, and I think I've had
kids like 7-8 years old who get into it like just like nothing. I actually ran my girlfriend's daughters and her through it, and they're 8 and 9, and they never played a role playing game before, and picked it up like nothing. I mean, they were a little bloodthirsty, but they were right into it. And I know that I think they have a kind of a campaign now going on at her cafe, and they're loving it. They're absolutely loving it, and that's one of the cool things is that it's so easy to get into now because you don't need to know that. Okay, so your armor class goes down and -4 is better than 5? I don't understand.
Yeah.
You don't need lots of charts. It's all concise right there on your sheet. They really simplified a lot of stuff. And they've really given you a system where if you want to go role-playing, where you're actually interacting and talking a lot, you can do that. But if you want to go role-playing where all you're doing is rolling dice and killing stuff, you can do that too. They've really created a well-balanced, I think, system for that.
I think you're right, and to marry those two, because you know, when fourth edition came along, it was tactical combat, and so it left role-playing behind, and which is why Pathfinder came in and ate their lunch, mm-hmm. And now. You know, like, you know, I think quite literally from the ashes, it's come up, and it's like, hey, you know, we're opening the door for, like, anybody who wants to play, you know, the truly new generation of geeks come in young and early, and we'll make this a good experience, and I think, and they're genuinely paying attention to the stories that they're creating.
Yes.
Yeah. Which is something, and they're, and you can see that by the involvement, by Chris Perkins' involvement, and like when he runs those things for Acquisitions Incorporated, you know, he gives a damn about story, and that's what's the most important thing. If you lose sight of the fact that it is story that people sign up for, you know, then you've lost. And tactical combat is not about story.
No. Well, and the story is actually is one thing that's been leading some people to complaining. Because they're focusing on story, they're not just going, hey, it's 4:45 on Tuesday, here's another supplement. Hey, it's Wednesday morning, another supplement. Next 3 days later, another module. It's very slow paced. I mean, the Rage of Demons stuff doesn't come out till September. And there are people who are saying, you know, it's like, well, we want more stuff. Now, me being the, held my old man moment of, back in my day, we made things up sometimes. and I was talking with my boss about that whole thing of some of the people complaining, and we both agreed that, you know, people being forced to use their imaginations a bit is probably good for the long run.
Yes.
And I remember when open license first came out, and anybody who could put two words together released a D&D supplement. And you did get some good stuff, but you got a lot of crap, too.
Well, you know, and that kind of falls under the category of when you open source anything.
Yeah.
And we're looking at, like, technology. And I remember having this discussion with... I work in web design and support and things like that in my everyday job. And I remember having a discussion with one of the developers about open source. And this is before I, you know, had fully wrapped my head around what it was about. And that was my objection. Well, anybody could put out anything. And his response was, you know, the people decide what's good out of that. You know, you open this up, you have people submit things, that which is bad kind of falls by the roadside, and the things that really are bright and shining come to the fore, and people follow that route. They follow that, whatever you want to call it, they follow that thing. And that's how you prove that something is worthwhile. So, yeah, there are pros and cons to doing something that is open like that, but, I mean, if you... And because we have the internet, you can always check reviews and things like that and look for the diamonds and leave the chaff behind, as it were, and pick up the good things.
Yeah. I think I sidetracked you again. I'm sorry.
No. This is how our conversations with news typically go. We're going to move on to the second story, and I've really kind of been following Universal Adventures a little bit. It's such a cool concept. The story comes from TabletopGamingNews.com, and it's Universal Adventures Adventure Module Number 4, Death Knell Delve. The titles for all of their Universal modules are wonderful tongue twists. And this is part 2. They had a Death Knell Delve part 1, and now part 2 is available. New Realms Publishing sends you further down into the depths of their Universal Adventure Module Number 4, Death Knell Delve part 2. This is their largest module to date, with 108 cards of monsters, traps, treasures, and other encounters for your players. Whatever fantasy RPG system you're playing, you can incorporate the Death Knell Delve into it. And that's the thing that I really find fascinating with Universal Adventures. You could be playing Champions, you could be playing D&D 5th Edition, you could be playing Pathfinder, and you can incorporate these general all-purpose monsters into whatever system you're playing in. And this is really kind of an idea primer and giving you an outline in which to run your group through, which is really kind of cool. But the other thing, too, is the way this is structured is you can play this by yourself. So let's say you're somebody who maybe lives out in a rural area and you love D&D, but you don't really have anybody around that can play with you, or it's really hard to get a group together, you can actually run a Universal Adventures game by yourself and run a character, your character through it, which is really kind of fascinating.
That is. I used to, as a kid who didn't have friends to play D&D with, that would have been like the grail to me growing up.
Yeah. And yeah, because you lived out in a very beautiful area. I love that area where you grew up in, but yeah, that must have been really difficult to get a group together to play out there. The write-up for this is kind of interesting. Something evil has been unleashed in the depths beneath Ravenor. Will you dare to delve deeper into the dungeons beneath Ravenor and put an end to the evil that threatens the town, or will you perish as you push further into the Death Knell Delve? I just love that write-up that they have there, too. You got to say it with a dramatic voice, though, to really get the feel for it. So, I mean, we've kind of sort of tentatively given a thumbs up on this. We think that's kind of a cool idea. Do you see more of a future, or maybe more companies attempting to create general purpose adventures like this? I mean, it's a great concept. I mean, you know, we talked a little bit about not having enough people complaining about not having enough supplements for 5th edition. Do you see using something like this that is slightly open-ended? I mean, you get these monster cards, you get traps and treasures and stuff like that, a general outline. Do you see people maybe taking these and piecing together maybe their own adventure based on this? Do you see this as a major plus for the gaming industry?
Absolutely. I would think that this is the type of stuff that I love, because it's not a full-blown, here's everything pre-prepared and we can spoon-feed you every bit of dialogue and every little encounter, because those of us who ever run a game know that players go, oh, that's the door we should go through. What's over here?
Right.
And yep. And this is why I do so much of my game mastery is I have a rough, very rough outline and I'll have some monsters and encounters, but I can drop those in anywhere. So it's like, if I want the players to go right and they go left, it's not a problem for me. And with this type of stuff where you have just that outline, it's easier to adapt to whatever insane bullshit the players decide to come up with. You can roll with it. And I love the stuff that is supportive of one player. One, sure. as someone who works in a store, this is a huge selling point when especially when it's a mom or a dad who doesn't know the first thing about, like, say, D&D, and wants something for their son or daughter, and it's like, you tell them, okay, this and blah blah blah, and they can play it by themselves. And the parents' eyes light up, like, yes, I don't have to learn how to do this, because as much as a lot of parents love their children, you know, there are things that almost every child does that the parent is like, that's great, keep doing what you're doing, but. Now, mind you, this is, you know, a lot more fun than, you know, playing Candyland for the 78th time, but still, there's this, you know, everyone has their own interests, and not every parent, I mean, even if they have that, they'll play with the kid, there's still that disconnect if they're not really into it.
Sure.
So that's great. And then also, as someone who, I sell games all day long, and I interact with people all day long, and sometimes I just want to be left the fuck alone, but I still want to play a game, and I don't always want to be sitting in front of a computer screen to do it.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I have plenty of games that I play solo. Even some that aren't meant to be played solo, I'll still play solo. Has that feature, it's like, yeah, sign me up.
Very cool. How do you feel about it, Pat?
You know, I think, I think things like that are kind of a vital in-between step, because it's a huge step between, like, playing a module, you know, or effectively using a prepackaged world, which I'm with you, Glenn. I never went in for that. You know, people would talk about what was the Arabian Nights one that D&D did back in the day. Jerry was from Penny Arcade, like, had a religious experience about it when he was a kid, like, about how rich it was, and all these, it was just, they effectively made a world, and, like, here's all the information you want about the world, go play and make stories in it.
Okay.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. You know, that sounds kind of familiar. But, so they would do that, and it's a big step between that, between having all of that. Well, it's like, here's the world, and then here's a module. Here's a specific adventure with all the information you need. And the only step in between that and making everything up on your own, that's a huge gap. And so if you effectively have, you know, what I almost think of as like a framework or a toolbox to say, you know, here's a collection of things. Maybe you could put these together in different ways. You know, because that's, I mean, thinking in storytelling terms, that's how we write. The first writing we usually do is effectively fanfic. You take things that you love and you're like, well, yeah, Twilight was good, but why not dinosaurs too? And so you do Twilight with dinosaurs, and that's the book that you write. I think there's a big place for these supplemental things, like, I want to create my own world or create my own adventures, but I'm not entirely sure, like, what the best way is to do that. How do you do that? And so you give, the more tools you have, the easier it is to create those adventures. Or even if you do it and you love it, it's hard sometimes. You're like, God, another trap, another, I need NPCs. Do I got to make them all from scratch?
Yeah, yep.
So, because it's basically, it's the, anyone, to make it super simple, is the module is, I can read a book. And that leap up to the, all the way over to, I'm going to write my own book.
Right. That's
you can attest to how easy that is, Pat, of writing your own book.
It's a breeze. Yeah, it takes you like 14 years, and that's it. Just 14 years, you can do it.
Yeah. I don't know if I want to wait 14 years between RPG adventure.
That's exactly
that might be a bit much. And I mean, and there are some people who will never be able to make that final leap. But if you give them that little something that they can have at least some input, I think that's fantastic. Because not everyone's ever going to be able to all of a sudden just go, I'm making everything up myself. I mean, I know people who have been role-playing for years who will agonize over just coming up with a name for a character because they don't know what to do.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and honestly, like, even if you are a pro and even if you do it all the time, there's usually one or two things that just absolutely trip you up. You're like, oh, God, I've got to make the map. You know? Yeah. You got to say, I've got to draw this map, and I suck at drawing so much. And for me, a lot of times, it's like, I can come up with the story concept just fine. But, you know, what I need help with is, like, the names. I can obsess for half an hour on a name for a character. But if I had, like, name box, you know, like a little box full of, like, 3x5 cards with names on them, go, oh, you know, there, this is the name for the character. That's what I need help with. That would be my preferred crutch.
Sure.
Boggle dice. That's what my friend used to do to name people in his games. He would roll boggle dice and he would just pull things out that made some kind of sense.
You know, it got to be a sort of shorthand for us, where they would say, you know, they would go say, what's this person's name? And I would say, Bob. And they would go, oh, okay, good. Because they knew that person was effectively window dressing.
Sure.
It's sort of like, it's almost like the Truman Show, you know, when he would turn to he'd start talking to the woman at the table next to him, and she'd be paralyzed with fear. She's like, I'm not supposed to talk to you. Like, I don't have anything planned for this character. They're not that important. They're named Bob. Please be aware that they are a non-clickable object, and unless you want to be a dick to me and derail this story, maybe play along and let's go where it's going to be fruitful somewhere else. Because only important people have names other than Bob.
I think when I put together Dirgewood, I think, yeah, the names were the hardest part, I think, for me. And that was the Wild West Hunters Hunted in the vampire setting. In White Wolf. Names just always were something that I can just go to a name generator and just, yeah, there you go, boom, done.
That's always been the easiest part for me. Really? If I could do all the rest of my writing the way I come up with names, I would have about a billion novels written.
Well, and you know, there is you know, I think a huge part, like, of being a writer, you got to know what your strengths are and you have to know what your weaknesses are. Because the strengths are the things that you want to do the most of, and the weaknesses, you have to be aware that you suck at that so that you can, like, limp through it.
Yeah.
And, you know, and honestly, one of the huge, because I've never played Pathfinder. I had no particular attachment to 3.5, and so I had no need to cling to it, and I didn't have a gaming group when all of that transitioned into 4th edition came out. But I did pick up the books and reading through the GM's guide and looking at, like, their storytelling tips. I'm like, oh my god, if I had known this stuff 20 years ago, like, every game I ran would have been 10 times better. Like, the graph they said, here's a traditional, and it's like, and they did it as a flow chart. Here's how the game session works. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's like, or you can do this. And it goes, it's that diamond-shaped, you know, allowing for more choice from the players, or it's this circle shape. And I'm like, this is brilliant. Whoever did this, it was like a huge service to all of gaming to make that available to people, because, you know, what are the odds that you're going to be good at world building, good at character creation, good at character portrayal, good at plot, good at pacing, you know, good at improvisation, good at planning, good at naming, you know, like all of those things, you know, that's why it's so hard to find good GMs.
Yes.
If you get somebody who's good at half of those, they'll be a good GM as long as they can focus on their strengths. But, you know, the more resources we have to shore up our weaknesses, the better off everybody is.
All right. Well, playing to my strengths, I think I know what my novel that I'm going to write is. It's going to be the name of names. It's just going to be a novel with just names. That's it.
I'm gonna kind of continue with the tradition on the show. For my money, Todd Roll was.
And
the people listening to this have no idea who Todd Roll is.
And I don't know who Todd Roll is.
Yes, you have not. You haven't met Todd. Have you?
No, I have not.
In
I don't
all
think
this
so.
Time. And he and Pat and I have had the good fortune of playing with him in, you know, he ran the X-Men game that we played. I think I came in at the very end of that. And then you weren't available to get into the Golden Age game that he ran in.
Yeah, I still regret that. No, he is. I mean, I have to say, the top tier GM, you know, who is doing it pro now, it's Chris Perkins. The way that he runs those Acquisitions Incorporated games, mm-hmm. Dude is a unicorn, right? He's, you know, he's got the entire suite, you know, fully, he's like completely maxed out his development tree there in all these GMing skills. But, you know, Todd is like right below him, you know, in this ranking system. And he has the ability to run this game with such like a light hand on the reins, and it's a marvelous thing. If you guys can ever get him on here to talk about it, he's so good.
Two episodes ago when we talked to Ian, I kind of laid out my plan. I'm going to mention Todd in an organic way. It's not going to be something where and Todd Roll. It's going to come up in an organic way, and I want people who listen to this, to the Adventure Party on a regular basis, to get little bits and pieces. And I want to have an episode, and maybe Glenn would sit that one out. I don't know, but I would like to do like a love letter episode to Todd Roll, and then have a number of people that have gamed with him. And you know, because that's the one thing. And as we're talking about this, storytelling a game, all the skills that you need to make a game that is worth a damn, to make a game where you talk about that game for the rest of your life, where you go, oh, God, there's that one game or that one session that just totally blew me away. The things that you need as a storyteller to make that perfect storm of the memorable gaming session takes either incredible luck or incredible skill. And for it to be a regular occurrence, obviously that takes skill. And Todd is one of those people that has that skill to always, you know, we talked about this a couple of episodes ago with Ian, where he knows individually what your thing is that you want to get out of a game.
Yeah.
And to have the skill to be able to mentally index, you like story, you like to fight, you like to find, you know, weird mystical things. You want mystery. You want intrigue. You want something. And to be able to keep that index and to be able to keep people invested, to keep people moving forward in their own personal character development and their own personal gaming experience development, to be able to do that at the level that he does is a rare skill. And I think that the people out there that have that skill, those Todd Rolls that we'll call them at this point, they don't get that appreciation, I think. I think a lot of people just go, wow, that was really cool, and don't take the time to go, thank you. That was amazing. And I would like to have an episode, now the cat's out of the bag, but you know, I would like to have an episode where it's kind of like, hey, some of us have played with you and not necessarily bore people with stories, but to kind of give people stories about Todd and what he's done as a storyteller to give us the thing that we've all kind of wanted out of a game, and to thank him for it, because I think that needs to be done.
Broaden that up a little bit and make it love letters to our GMs in general.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, get some from your audience, because everyone has that game that they played that they remember. And it's like, it's been 15 years, and it's like, that was awesome. I remember that.
Yep. No, that's a great idea. And I'm going to write that on my list of episode ideas, and I will give you credit for it.
Yeah, so thank you for that. Yes.
All right. Well, we're going to wrap up the news here. One of our contributors, Ryan Murphy, he does the Galactic Gaming News for us. And he has a regular bit that he also does for Galactic Netcasts that you can check out on galacticnetcasts.com. And he covers more of the digital beat. Glenn and I tend to land more on the board gaming, tabletop gaming, and the RPG side, pen and paper. But Ryan Murphy covers more of the digital side. And he's got an update for us that we're going to get to right now. So take it away, Ryan. All right, thanks for that, Ryan. We're going to get right back into it now. We're going to talk about a Kickstarter spotlight. We do this every week. We talk about a Kickstarter that we think that people should really check out. It's caught my attention or Glenn's attention, or it's been something that's been buzzed about on the internet, and we check it out and we want to share that with people. But before we get into that, we want to recap the one that we highlighted from the previous week. Now, the one that we highlighted last week was called Lord of the Dead. And the reason why it intrigued us so much is that it's a throwback to the 70s and 80s and the mini games, the little chits that you have on a card. And it's got the beauty of this thing is you can fold it up and put it in your pocket, and it's got the little chits for you to track the Lord of the Dead's progress and your villagers, and to have this fight. You get 60 town folk counters, 22 Grey Lord of the Dead counters. You've got all these beautiful little things, and they all are in a very tiny package. And for what you get, and literally, if you pledge $8 for this, you get in on it. You get a game that you can play. And the goal for this, believe it or not, was $900. At this point, he's raised over $10,000.
Oh, good for him.
And 15 days left to go. This is going to happen. And while we were doing last week's episode, when we talked about this, I ordered one. I jumped in on the Kickstarter while we were doing the episode. This is really kind of a cool thing. It actually garnered a Kickstarter staff pick stamp of approval on it. So this is a big deal, and he's been regularly emailing updates and answering questions from people, which is a true mark of a non-fly-by-night operation. You know, sometimes you'll throw money in at a Kickstarter, and you'll be lucky if you get an update. But he's been doing regular updates, letting people know what's going on and answering questions. So this is something, there's still 15 days left, at least at this point in time, for you to get on board with it, and it's called Lord of the Dead, an asymmetrical hex encounter micro game by Christopher Ferguson. So you should really, really check that out. And that wraps up the recap. Glenn's got our new Kickstarter that we wanted to share with you. So what you got?
I have War Quest. This is a big honking tabletop war game. Not minis, but well, I mean, it has minis, but it's still a board game. You play it on a board. Brought to us by, which seems to be a recurring theme, is now Mr. B Games.
Yes.
I was talking with at the open house I was at. I actually saw the prototype, so the game is not finished. It's on Kickstarter. It is, first of all, you get a huge map. It's the map. The board you're playing is like 31 by 46 or something. You know, I mean, it's a giant area you play on, and it's what it is. It's a high fantasy strategy game. You play in the world of Marathia, and you are each taking on the role of a warlord, trying to reunite the Freshland under your banner. Because of course, you're the good guy; everyone else is the bad guy. So you have to do that. Like I mentioned before, I like games you can play solo. This has a solo play version as well.
Nice.
It's 1 to 5 players. I like how they describe it. It's War Quest is firmly rooted in theme-driven, dice-rolling, engaging fun of big-box Ameritrash map and miniatures game, combined with the advantage of newer gameplay mechanics and concepts that facilitate faster, more balanced, and more dynamic gameplay. The one thing that I really liked about this is that the minis that they have, a couple things about the minis. One, there's a ton of them.
Yeah, you're not kidding.
There's 100. The base game comes with 115 minis.
Wow.
And when I see minis, these are 25 millimeter, basically typical role-playing game scale minis. So 115. So you get tons of dwarves and elves, and a race you don't see very often, outside of like just some dude in the corner hanging out with the chicks, is satyrs.
Satyrs, yes.
You have a whole, you know, basic army of satyrs. And as a player, you can recruit any of these. You can recruit goblins and satyrs into your army. But I also like the way the minis are made. The bases they're on have these little like nubs that you want to say nubs when I'm talking about satyrs. But okay, little. Pits that, no matter what I say now, it's going to be that, but little bits that stick on the base, on the front and the back, that indicate their, basically their stats. How well they attack? Well, this guy has two on the front, so his attack power is two, and then, you know, on the back, so sure. It's built right into the base. You don't have to, you know, check some charts. Like, how good is the goblin, you know, infantryman compared to, you know, you can see on the battlefield, you can see what they do. And there's other interesting mechanics that they do where you actually have you have ranking where you have your melee guys up front and you might have some archers behind them, and your archers can pick and choose. The attacker decides who dies when you kill something. It's not the, oh, I'm the defender, you did four hits, I got these four scrub guys I'm just going to throw away. The attacker decides, unless someone's running dwarves. Because they like to get down and dirty and they like to get into the fight, they always take the first hits. So if you want to protect, throw a couple dwarves in front of them because the dwarves are going to get mopped up while all your archers can then, you know, unleash their rain of fire. And it's some interesting concepts. I mean, like I said, it's still, the game looks fairly complete from what I saw of it. And I went through a little bit of how it plays, but it looks great. And then the sculpts are actually pretty darn good. For something that is being, you know, very, I mean, that you're getting a lot of, you know, they put a fair amount of design to it. It's the same guys who made, and now I'm blanking on who did the minis. The guys who did the minis for Zombie Quest and Arcadia Quest, or Zombicide, sorry, Zombicide and Arcadia Quest are the ones who did the minis. And the stretch goals are just, there's tons of them. I mean, they've already, their goal was 75,000. And this went up 2 days ago, and they're already at 96,000.
It was fully funded in 32 hours.
Yeah, and to give you an idea, I mean, aside from there's the $2 pledge level where you get a digital copy of a WarQuest novella. After that, the next pledge level is $120. So you know this isn't like, you know, they didn't get like 10,000 people pledging $5 a piece. This is people throwing in $120 or more. And from when I spoke to the guy for Mr. B Games, he's hoping to retail this for about $100, $99 to $100, which that's a ton of stuff in a box for $99, 115 minis that technically you could use in any D&D or Pathfinder game as well. And I love games that I can use for multi-purpose stuff. It helps me rationalize buying as many games as I do as the, well, yes, this is a game and it's $100, but I can also use this game and other games I play, so therefore, it's like I'm getting two or three or four games in one. And just the stretch goals, now I have to remember what some of the stretch goals were. I mean, first they have some add-ons that you can get for elite troops, and they've got like a Wraith King.
The Wraith King is just ridiculously beautiful. Holy crap.
They've got like a dwarf on like an armored bear. They've got lots of great stuff like that. And then the stretch goals, man, there's so many freaking upgrades you can do. The stretch goals, let's see, at 85,000, which they've already hit, they add the Orc Halberdier, and they have new minis to add. At 95,000, they already hit. You get the Seder Stick Fighter. So you got more minis there. Then at 100,000, you got Experience Dice add-on packs. 110 is more goblins. 120 is better battle mat. They're going to have to add more stretch goals because they're going to hit the 120,000 pretty darn quick. You can already look at the rules online. They've got a link where you can check out the rules. They've got videos that video that goes through gameplay and how a turn works and how combat works. They've got you can look at the whole map online. There's already a couple of reviews out, previews and reviews. Tom Vassell, if you do the Dice Tower thing, he's already got a preview from Gamma, and just it looks like a lot of fun. I mean, I like war games. I don't get to play them as often as I want to because generally they can be a time suck. Yeah. They really can. This one, he said, it's about 45 minutes to an hour per player. So if I can get a good, fun war game in like 3 hours, that's fantastic.
Yeah, it is.
That's a bit of a rarity.
Yeah, yes. I think we mentioned previously when Rob Benton wielded out his... I think we played that at your childhood home, Pat, when he pulled out... Game of Thrones, the board game.
And all right.
Once we got into hour six, I was like, I am no longer mentally invested in this
game. Yeah, that was the mistake of, let's play this game. It's midnight. We can start this now.
Let's play quick game of Civ. Yeah.
Because that always works. You know, I could see this kind of, with everything that you get in this, I mean, like you mentioned, you can get, you know, the miniatures for your regular D&D stuff, but I could see you kind of running this like cheap-ass games because you get the plastic gold and silver tokens, the coins, and you get a couple of other things here that I think could definitely be repurposed for other things. So I think that you can easily rationalize, you know, dropping $120 for something that you can easily repurpose into, you know, normal gameplay or other games that you might be interested in, or if you're looking to make your own. Or you have your own ideas, you could always repurpose and do your own cheap-ass version of something. No, that's really cool. That's a great find, Glenn. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And just like everything else that we talk about, the news stories and the Kickstarters, we will include links to this in the show notes. So if you miss it, you can always find it in wherever you get your feed, and you can click the link and get to this. So.
And not to... Yeah, at the risk of maybe doing something gauche. I forget, when does this go? I know we're live now, but when will this go up for the feed?
That's a very good question. I'm glad you asked that. I am currently an episode behind, and I'm finishing up editing that one tonight. So this particular meeting of the Adventure Party will go up probably the end of next week.
Okay.
So probably
then there's a Kickstarter, There's a Kickstarter which I will not mention because it'll be done by then.
Oh shoot! I wish that.
It's one that I myself have not talked about a lot online, so there's no reason you should know about it.
Okay.
Because the world revolves around Patrick Rothfuss. If he hasn't spoken the word, no.
I kind of assume that everyone always knows what I'm involved in. You know, why should I even bother talking about it? if you guys are curious, though, it's...
Absolutely.
It's by it's the new game by Selinger, who did the Pathfinder card game, as well as Betrayal on House on the Hill. Yeah, Mike Selinger, he's doing Apocrypha. It's got 4 days left, and I'm writing a tiny piece of it. Along with some other writers. He needed somebody to write some story fragments, and he tapped me for it. So I just shared that particular news a couple of days on Facebook, although it's been up on the Kickstarter itself for a while, so it's certainly no secret. But I think there's only 4 days left on that Kickstarter.
See, now I have to find it.
don't sweat it right now. It's doing very well. It's not like it needs help across the finish line.
If you want to find it quick, just go to my Google Plus page. I just shared it from Pat like 10 minutes before he mentioned it.
No, yeah, it's like 347% funded. They were looking for, I like this figure, $66,666.
even better. All of the buy-in goals are like $66.66. It goes all the way through like that.
Wow, this looks like a wonderful. I wish I could. Yeah, this is a wonderful looking game. Holy crap!
It's gonna be. I mean, it's Mike Selinger. I mean, we've played Betrayal at House on the Hill together. Yes. And he was in kind of in charge of that. So, I really am riding the brake on new projects these days. But when he said, come out to play, and I'm like, no. And he's like, yes, I'm gonna do a thing. So I'm like, yeah, let's do it.
See, okay, I'm gonna mark this to remind me. I have to double check my checking account to make sure I can afford the $66 and pick this up, because this looks awesome. Oh, that's beautiful. All right. Well, we kind of did loosely mention it. By the time do you know of his plans after Kickstarter, if this is going to then be retail, if it's going to show up some other way?
No, absolutely. It will be showing up in other places. One of the things, part of one of the ways that he sweet talked me into the project was by promising some help to world builders, because we at this point do a lot of game tie-in stuff, and we sell games in the store, or we do special promos with games, and then we sell those promos in our store alongside the games to make it a little more interesting to people. It'll be showing up in retail. It'll be showing up in our online store. It won't be hard to find. It's just you won't be the first in the door.
Okay, and that's cool too. And we're definitely going to talk about World Builders here and the charity and the stuff that you're doing here. If you haven't started it already for the Indiegogo campaign, we'll definitely talk more about that. And because this is a perfect segue, because now we're back into the interview portion. Woohoo! I threw together some questions here, and we've kind of hit a couple of things earlier when we were speaking in the intro. And I had the good fortune of stumbling across the recent AMA that you did. And one thing that I wanted to ask you about and kind of follow up on is you mentioned that there's a lot of the world that exists, but nobody sees it but you. Okay. And getting back into this whole world building, because that's the topic that we're in right now, in constructing something, you painstakingly sat down and thought about a lot of things in your world to have it, in your back pocket and ready to go when you were writing. As somebody constructing, as a storyteller, creating, and I'm not even talking about creating their own system. Let's say they're going to run a game in White Wolf, or run something in Hero system, or whatever their particular RPG of choice is. How important do you think it is to have all the details of the particular setting within that world? How detailed do you think they need to go? Like if a player maybe goes off on a tangent, should you be ready for something like that, or does that way lie madness?
That way definitely lies madness. And I think, I mentioned already when looking at Pathfinder and some of the suggestions they made there, the way that they flow charted a story to show how that can all fit together, that was, that was useful. But one of the other tips that was so obvious in retrospect was, if you think, I need to have the whole world ready in case, like, they go into a store. You know, it's like I'm expecting them to go into the potion shop and the temple, and that's it. And then they got to get out of town. And then they decide to go and buy a horse. And you're like, shit, I didn't plan on having a stable. You know, and so you lock up. You're in there like, oh, I don't have a farrier in my, you know, in my box of index cards. I have not created this person. What's his personality? What's his name? You know, if your plan is to have everything so that no matter where they go, there's something, you simply cannot. You know, okay. Like, it's not in any way sensible. Assuming, you know, even if you had the amount of time free that you did when you were 17, you know?
Yes, yeah.
But, like, any adult who has a moderately busy life, you know, just you start to realize that you need payback for the time you invest.
Yeah.
And in Pathfinder, what they said is, let's say that there's 12 different countries, you know, and you need, you know, all of these things. What if your people can teleport? They can cast a teleport spell. And so suddenly, you know, they could go to any one of these countries. And you're like, oh, God, I've got to make all these countries in case they teleport there. And Pathfinder says, you really don't. You make one. You make like a little set of noblemen, and here's maybe a throne room or whatever. And so if they go, it's like we want to go to Calpurnia. And you're like, poof. There, you're in Calpurnia, and here are your nobles, and here are your whatever. Sure. So you're like, wow, he has it already. Now, similarly, and this is one of the things, because I asked Todd once how, you know, in one of this really, really great games that he ran for us, and this was truly back in the day, this was like 20 years ago, showing that like he's been good at this for a long, long time. He didn't, you know, part of it is craft that he's developed. A part of it is that he's known just from the get-go. You know, it was, the whole world was effectively this little town and then another little town. And there's a road that goes through it, and there's an inn, and there's the old woman that lives in the woods, and here's the monastery where the monks are. But that is effectively, it's the whole world. It's a small little world, and everyone grew up in this little town, and there's a cast of characters. And I remember that the game was so packed full of things. Like, things were always happening. There was never a dull moment. We were never stuck kind of like, oh, what do you want to do? Oh, I don't know. What do you want to do? You know, or it's like, or you're like, should we do this or should we do this? And then there's like a 30-minute argument discussion about what you're going to do next, because you would spring something on us and we're like, oh God, we've got to go do this right now. And it kept the game moving.
Sure.
And he was like digging through his stuff. He's like, oh, here's my notes from this game. And I'm like, can I see those? And I see what he had was he had figured out what each place was like. And then there was something that could happen at each place.
Okay.
And so we went to the inn, and he knew that in the basement of the inn, there was some shady dealings, and there were some people who had like had the classic fairy tale wolf hide. They could turn into wolves by wearing these wolf hides.
Sure, okay.
And so there were rumors about this, you know, that we had heard, but nothing pressing, nothing that was immediately like, oh my God, we need to solve this mystery, but we'd heard about it. And so we decided to go to the inn, and while we were at the inn, he had, like, in the basement, the innkeeper was one of these people. And so in the basement, one of the big wine barrels, you know, was actually a fake one, and behind it was this secret room where they did their rituals and whatever. He had that there, and so as soon as we went to the inn, you know, if we'd gone to the inn and we, like, bought a beer, and then we're like, now we need to go to the monastery and talk to the abbot. We could have gone to the monastery. But as soon as we hunkered down there, it was pretty sure that we were going to be falling into that story, into that wolf pelt storyline.
Okay.
And then all he had to do was get us into the basement, and then if there was trouble or whatever, it's I think either you know, either you sneak into the basement and you explore it, in which case you find this, or you get into trouble, you sneak into the basement, you get caught, and there's a fight, and somebody gets thrown through this false barrel. And you feel like you're so freaking smart because you found this clue in this place, and the world feels very rich because no matter where you go, something is happening, but it's a shell game. But the thing is, it doesn't matter because your experience as a player is very rich. So, yes, he did his work. Yes, he built this world. But what he did, and this is the reason he's a better GM than I am, he built these things knowing that he was going to kind of lead people into them.
Sure.
Whereas what I will do 20 times as much world building, and then I let people loose, and they kind of run all over. And when I lean on them, I lean way too hard. And if I don't lean, then sometimes I'm too careful about like holding back my information because I'm like, if I just put them in the basement and they find the secret cask, then it's going to feel fakey.
True.
You know? Yeah. But it doesn't. It wouldn't. I'm just too nervous about it. I want to make them either work too hard or I want to push them too hard. So I actually do more world building and it has less of a good effect. Because, again, he's better at holding the reins of the game.
Okay. You know, you talked about when you did your testing, your play testing, or exploring your world through an RPG setting, you used champions, you used heroes. If that system didn't exist, what other system would you or might you have chosen?
It couldn't have been D&D. There's just no way it can fit into that system. I've had people talk to me about it, and they say, I've been trying to do your world in D&D. Do you think like a sympathist should be like a warlock? And I'm like, no, it just doesn't work. You know, and they're like, it's both like a bard, wizard, multi-class. And I'm like, no, I mean, it just doesn't work. Like D&D is built for the D&D world.
Yeah.
You know, like D&D really only works in the D&D world where there are classes, and the world is based around adventurers, and you get levels, and you amass treasure, and then you kill things and get more treasure and goods and stuff. And that's why it works really well, because the system and the story work really well together.
Yeah.
You know, like any game, like Portal is great, because the game mechanic and the story go really well together.
Yes, yep.
And sometimes you get a great mechanic and a great story, and they don't work well together, and it sucks, and you don't know why. And sometimes, I mean, that's what happens, I think, when you get really lousy movies, you know, or really lousy games, and you're like, but everybody involved was brilliant.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you need them to fit together in the right way. You know, would the storytelling system work out? No, because storyteller is for a white wolf.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? I mean, you could not do it. You know, well, could you make the mage system work? Well, first edition mage was just...
It's so horribly complicated.
Was a hot mess, and we're dating ourselves here. But part of me thinks that Fate might be... Like, but I have not played Fate. I've only read the core Fate system rule book. I think it would work, but I've never played in it and I've never run it. I think if I had to pick another one, I think that's open enough to allow for the character creation.
Sure.
But what's really interesting is I think it's like almost the diametrical opposite of champions.
Yeah.
It's like no math. You know, no point base, whatever. It's like It's like so loose. And I think I would love to try some Fate, but I don't have a gaming crew these days.
And I've got, it was a gift from a friend, and he got me the Dresden Files RPG, which is based off of Fate.
Yeah, I've seen the book, and I am so viciously jealous that I will never be able to do what they have in that book, because do you have the book?
I don't have it with me, but I've only looked through it briefly. There was talk about our local gaming group running Dresden Files, but it never quite gelled, and we stuck with Pathfinder, unfortunately. So
what's brilliant about it is that in the books, Harry has a group that he games with.
Yes.
And yep. So the entire concept of this gaming book is it's his geek gamer friends get together to create a game based on this supernatural world that Harry has clued them into and that they've seen the edges of. And so here's what makes it truly shine is that they've effectively put together all the rules and they've handed it to Harry. And Harry has gone through and in the margins, he's like, yeah, I see. Yeah, this is right, guys. But you have to take this out if you're going to print it because you're not supposed to know about the White Council and they will come after you and kill you. and I think Bob even annotates some shit. Which is brilliant. So, and I'm so jealous that no matter what game I do, I will never be able to engage in that meta level, source book that Jim has managed to pull off with that team.
That makes me love Butcher so much more. It really does.
Well, and, I will say my hat is truly off to the people who put it together because I talked to Jim and he had a very light, if almost non-existent, hand on the tiller for the development of that. Apparently they put it together and brought it to him and he's like, wow, yeah, pretty much exactly that. Except, whoa, you made some guesses that were really good about you have to take this shit out because this is actually happening in future books. And you can't talk about it, So they grokked exactly what was going on in the books to a profound degree. I'd pick Fate. That was a long-winded answer to that question.
Okay, because for people who are listening to this, we talk about heroes and champions. The thing that Pat is really talking about, and hero system champions is very math intensive. And when Rob spoke with us in the second episode, and we talked about min-maxing, and we talked a little bit about the math and champions, heroes, and you need a program literally to help you figure out the math to make everything work, because without it, you need a slide ruler and a good understanding of calculus to really make it happen on a pen and paper.
I did it back in the day,
Well, that makes you better than me, because I suck at math.
Brad can't math.
I can't math at all. I'm lucky I can do my taxes. I've got a computer program for that, thank God. but the thing about Hero is, for as math intensive as it is, it is very flexible, and it allows if you are, and Rob made the example, just so people have a point of reference, you can be a magician and have the power be innate to you, or you can have the power be in a book that your magic user uses, and it's completely separate from you. And you have the ability to, with this same system, you can make a magic user who uses a book to use their power, or you could make somebody like Green Lantern who has a ring and does stuff, or you can, and Todd Roll, when we played and we talk about Todd Roll, what he did, we used Hero, and you could literally do fantasy with it. You could literally jump into a Golden Age superheroes campaign. You could do so much with it. And yes, it was math intensive, but the flexibility was just so appealing. And that's why it appealed to that group that we played with.
And same here. That's why, like, whenever I would play, whenever I would do something in my world, it's like, do I want to make alchemy in my world? Sure. It's like, I do not even have to tweak the hero system rules. I don't have to bend anything to make it fit. It's like, alchemy? Sure. Sympathy? Sure. Naming? Sure. It's like, actually, like, I worked out three different ways to do naming. You know, like, you're all using the existing hero system rules. I've done low fantasy, we've done X-Men fantasy, we've done, like, Victorian monster hunter, fantasy in hero system. I played, generic swashbuckling fantasy.
Did you get in on the, it was kind of a short-lived, but it was the, it was like the pulp era game. Sarah was a part of it. I thought maybe you had sort of made a character for it. I was playing sort of an Indiana Jones character, but as a Texan sort of a...
I missed that one. Hybrid. I played the more like Golden Age, where I played Stormbow, or Amaranth. Todd wanted to run superheroes, and I brought in a fairy, and it irritated him profoundly ever since.
Sure.
But, I mean, that's just it. You could have your Golden Age superhero, and then it's like, well, my Golden Age superhero is actually, it's like he is from the fairy realm. You know, in the same way that I think Kat's character was... like a Valkyrie or like the daughter of Freya or something.
Yeah, she was like Kitty Pride and some insert your badass character here.
So like it's a truly marvelous system, and I for when I played it, it gave me everything I wanted, because part of what I wanted was the ability to go deep down the rabbit hole and really control everything. But my tendencies lie in that direction. And so if you give me the ability to control everything, I will. And that is not to the good of the game.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I think if you pulled that away from me and made me do fate, and I'd say, I can actually only spend an hour making this character. No matter how much I obsess, I guess it's time to play.
And the beauty of, and for what little I see now, I really want to dig out my books again and take a look at that. I remember that in doing your character sheet, you actually came up with terms for, I mean, like words that described how your character did certain things. And you could say, because I work out a lot, I'm resilient, so I'm a distance runner, so I can actually run to keep up with, like if you're running after a car or somebody on a bike. You have the ability, you have flexibility because you're kind of structuring things around words, and then your storyteller gives you the amount of dice you need to roll based on that, if I recall correctly.
Now, I will say that actually, that was my rule. That was my homebrew, one of the very, very few that I ever brought into Hero. And what that, I think, signifies is that what I really wanted was a more flexible narrative element in this game.
Yeah.
Where I said, it's like, if you're resilient, because I wanted people to find, like, the core of their character, in a way that can be very hard if you're building them off 150 points and you can do anything.
Yeah.
And you're like, I have 18 powers and I do this and that. It's like, but what are you? What's really at the heart of you? You think of all these iconic characters. Like, what is Batman? Batman is... he's a badass.
Yeah.
What is Superman? Superman is... you could probably say, if you assign a few, because these are superheroes. So what is Superman? He is invulnerable, and he is American, he's pure, and that's what this iconic Superman is. What's Green Lantern? He is strong-willed. I mean, that's the core of the character.
And I would creative as maybe being a second word.
Yeah, absolutely. And so what I was trying to do is have people understand their characters, and I would give them a bonus. They'd be using the mechanics, and they'd say, well, I am trustworthy. And I'm like, you're right. Your character is trustworthy. And so you would get a bonus because you were doing something in your wheelhouse.
Sure.
And I think that was probably one of the first signs that hero... The perfect mathematical nature of hero was building an elaborate cage around me that I kind of wanted to get out of.
Yeah, I could see that. Huh. Yeah, that would be interesting to see this done in a fate system, to see how that would work with a stronger narrative and less of the math. Yeah.
Yeah.
That'd be fun.
Another really good flexible game would be this one called Mist Runner. But don't play it now, because Randy and I are actually revamping all the rules to make it better. So.
Oh, really? Cool.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. So there's going to be a Mist Runner version 2?
Of course. 2?
Excellent.
I need to make another, I think, $38 was my actual profit I ended up making when all is said and done. I need another $38.
But it's
I need to pay for half a copy of Apocrypha.
Right. But it's a labor of love, How many people can say that they've created their own game system? Not many. I'm looking at my... we sort of touched on this a little bit. And I guess I kind of want to see if there are maybe some more specifics. When you were playtesting things, what things worked surprisingly well, where you said, this is going to happen, and I'm going to do this, and people really went, oh, wow, that's the coolest thing ever. Is there anything that really stood out in your mind as being really strong?
The Cathay worked out really well in practice. I brought the Cathay into the game, and... that was never one of the ones that you were involved with. I think that might have happened out in Washington State, where I had some people interact with the Cathay, and it went so badly.
Oh, jeez.
It was just like, but it was perfect. It's like they all made very reasonable choices, and everyone said, you don't want to go there, you don't want to go there, it is terrifying, you don't want to go there. And they're like, boy, that sounds really... But, and so they did, and it just went wrong. And I actually, having played at least a little bit of Hero System, I actually built the Cathay, what was it? To give everyone an idea about the Hero System, one of the many flexible elements of it is... how many points you build a character on. And they say, a regular person might be 10 or 15 points. Like, an exceptional person might be based on 20 or 25 points. If you play, Marvel superhero, maybe, 350, 400 points. Like, DC superheroes, like the Justice, like Superman, is 650, 750 points. And it's all kind of variable, because you're talking about, well, when exactly are you talking about Superman? Here or here?
Yeah, yep.
Those things are very variable. But typically, the heroes that I would build, or I would have people build, it would be a very modest power level campaign where people would build on 75 points, and you get 75 points of the disadvantages, which means you're middle and fair badasses, but you're kind of like the Firefly crew. It's like
yeah.
You're not unstoppable. You are very good at what you do, but there are forces in the world that will stomp you flat if you run into them in the wrong way. And I built the Cathay, and because I knew what he needed to be able to do, and the Cathay was, I think, 1,200 points.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, you know, okay. And it's like, and like very easily 1,200 points, like maybe closer to 1,500 points. Did you ever play Champions or Hero, Glenn?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I can share this a little bit with you, and here for the five people out there that have done Hero System. He effectively, I think he had 20, like 15 or 20 D6 unluck usable as power against other sticky continuous permanent.
Sweet Jesus.
What about that?
You know? And so, like, absolutely, you see, there you go. That's exactly the response you should have. And it's like, and how did he use it? He effectively had to talk with you. You know, and I'm like, that's a perfect mechanism. And there were a lot of other things massaged in there, but I'm like, yeah, that accurately represents the impact that he will have on your existence. And the players, and this is actually a good example. I knew this mechanism. I knew, you know, and I built this thing, and I'm like, yep, like, they're 150, like, Superman should be about 600 points. The Cathay is somewhere between 1,200 and 1,500 points. You know, he's like, you know, it's like, you're like, Jesus would only be 1,000 points. You know, it's like Odin would be maybe 1,150, and then there's the Cathay up there around 1,500, where one of the big things is it wasn't like he had half of those points, and then I gave him a bunch of disadvantages. You know, like one of the everyday heroes was 75 points and 75 points of, like, you're kind of screwed up, either psychologically or physically, or you're cursed or whatever.
Yep.
And the Cathay was kind of just, he had, like, I think about 60 points of disadvantages. And the rest was just, I mean, yes, he is one of, like, the most powerful mythic creatures that exists. And if you run into him, no, it's like you really will just, it's just not going to go well for you. But what's important sometimes is, and what was nice about Hero, is I would make something for the world, and I would go, oh, you know what would be a cool idea? Because I think I watched, what was it? I watched that movie with the demon, and when the demon could touch someone, it could move into them immediately. It was from about 10 years ago, 15 years ago maybe. It was actually a pretty good movie. But the demon could leave if the person was killed. It would be forced out. Or
yeah, it was like with Denzel or someone like that, wasn't it?
I think so, yeah. But anyway, so I thought, wow, that's a cool idea. So I made it. I made it, and I'm like, wow, okay, 800 points. And that let me know that I could not unleash this thing on my characters.
Was that Fallen?
I think it was Fallen. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
And so that was the cool thing about the Hero System, is I made it so it could, like, if you touch this, it'll do this, and it can hop out of a body and whatever. And I go, ooh, 800 points. Right, okay. Oh, God, of course, if I unleash this thing on my heroes, it will simply destroy them. And so I brought it down. Oh, you know, and that's funny, because I brought it down, and I added some stuff, and I changed it around, and that actually is how I might have originally come up with the proto idea for the dancers. You know, they come up at the end of Name of the Wind, the thing that comes in to the inn, and it's in possession of the man. And it's behaving weird, and it's not speaking the right language, and they really rip it apart, and it won't die. And afterwards, they have like a very like frank talk. It's like, what the hell was that? And Bast is like, I don't know. I know it was bad, and so I tried to kill it, you know? But that's actually where I originally had the idea for that. But it went through many, many permutations. I effectively playtested it until it was functional in my world as like a Midland threat. You know, I couldn't drop that demon from Fallen into the end of the book because it's just like he screws around with everyone, has his fun, and then everyone dies. You know? Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Now we. I'm looking through my list of questions here, and I'm like, oh, I think we covered that. Yeah, we mentioned earlier that Will Wheaton worked with Green Ronin to create more of a blank slate, more of a generic system, in which he could apply what he's doing on his new RPG tabletop series on YouTube, and. Speaking of that, if you would you with a blank slate system like that, could you see? Yeah, maybe we've kind of talked about this. It would King would you do anything with the King Killer Chronicle with a game company if the mechanics were right?
Oh sure, you know it's like I've always wanted to make like an RPG book based in my world, so people could go and play there. It's always been one of the things I wanted to do the most. The problem is, you know, again, I love Champions, but it's not. Yeah. If I do Champions, it's like saying, hey, everyone. You know, in the same way that I wouldn't want to do it if the book cost $1,000.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to do it if the initial investment is going to be 20 hours. You know, asking somebody to spend 20 hours before they can really understand what's going on and enjoy playing,
yeah,
that's not fun for everyone. Some people have $1,000, some people have 20, you know, 20 hours, but it's not a fair thing to ask for people that just want to come in and have fun.
Yeah.
So, so I want... Here's the perfect scenario. What I do is I get together all of the supplementary material, like effectively all of the info about the world that I want to put into these books, and then I say, all right, everybody, come and buy a license, and you can build your system around this material. You know, and if you can do proof of concept and show me that my world will function in your rule set, you can, you know, we could put it in like Will's system. We could put it in Fate. We could do it in Champions because some people love Champions and some people are like, yes, give me all of the points. I would love spending 20 hours making a character because I was that person for 20 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know that those people are out there. So why not let them do that? That's my perfect scenario. The problem is for one, there's things that I would need to put in these books that I can't let into the public domain until book three is out.
Yeah.
And the other thing is it would be a huge time investment. And I'm, you guys know, like, if an RPG book sells, like, 5,000 copies, it is, like, a breakout runaway success.
Yeah, yep.
And for me to spend the amount of time that it would take to put some, given my obsessive nature, right? I'm a controlling, freaky, you know, goddamn, like I have to have everything just perfect. To do that, you know, the amount of time I would put in, even if we sold 10,000 books, I would love to make those 10,000 people happy. But if I spent that time instead writing a novella, I would make like 500,000 people happy because they would get a new thing that they could read.
Yeah.
So it's right now I haven't been able to justify it, but it will happen.
But you're neglecting to think of one of the great benefits of making an RPG is then you could be constantly hounded with the When's the next module coming out? When's the next module coming out? When's the next module coming out?
And there it is.
Wow.
There it is.
And that would be the, I mean, because I sold, you know, I think 400 total copies of my game. And I get a couple people when I go to a con who ask, when is something else coming out? And based on the success of your books and RPG, there'd be a lot of people going, well, when's the next source book coming out? When do we get to know about this stuff? And that'd be the thing, too. It's all those things that you have in your pocket that we don't know about yet. People be asking like crazy, but I want to play in this part of the world.
I kind of wonder if, you know, if you don't talk to Jim Butcher and find out how that perfect storm happened for Harry Dresden with Fate. And
what I would do, honestly, is I would go to those people and I would say, and the thing is, our books are so different. Our series are so different.
Yeah.
Because what Jim does, first off, he's written much, much more, just in terms of sheer volume. And so and also what happens is the book starts and Harry says, so here's the thing about potions. And he explains all about how potions work. And then he says, he runs into the Red Court. He goes, so here's the thing about Red Court vampires. And you learn all about Red Court vampires. You learn all about werewolves. You learn all about the Nagaloshi. You learn all about these things. And so then, that's part of the fun of each of those books, is you learn all those things.
Yeah.
You know, and the mystery is effectively, there's certain overarching mysteries that last for many books. But generally speaking, his game is... he's slowly revealing elements of this vast world, but he reveals all of them. And so those books are you don't have to, they're easy to mine for information. Yeah. Whereas mine, I very deliberately, I stay way back. It's like, I don't pull a Tolkien and say, so, you know, here's how it works in the Shire. You know, and by the way, there's this tradition where everyone gives each other gifts. And, you know, because of that, there's something called a mathome. And actually, there's a museum for the mathomes or whatever. And you're like, really? Is this the beginning of The Lord of the Rings? I'm reading about, you know, God, somebody throw a fucking pie. Make something happen in this book. And I'd say that with love to Tolkien, right? You know, he's the granddaddy of fantasy. But, you know, he was saying, look at this cool part of the world. And you're like, actually, yeah, that's really cool. But I actually try to keep most of that out of the books, except for tiny little tastes. And so what would happen, you know, I explain the magic in some detail because it's really important for people to understand.
Yeah, yes.
Later in the book. But, like, they could not go into my book and say, well, obviously, here is how the government works in the Commonwealth. They couldn't, because I don't give you any of that information. You know, there's nobility.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Well, at least at this point in time in the books, it's not important. You know,
it's really not. And that's why I haven't put it in there. Yeah. But it would be really important in a game world.
Yeah, yes, you're right.
And so I would either have to write it or vet it. And honestly, vetting it would be just as bad as writing it, because they would write it and I'd go, oh, okay, we got no easy, and I'll just do it.
Yeah.
And so maybe I'm overestimating it. Maybe we could sit down and they could give me a lot of coffee, and over the space of 3 days of them asking really pointed questions and then taping my response, maybe I could just give them all that information verbally and they could put it together into something beautiful. It's a cool concept. And probably the first people I would go to would be the people that did Jim Butcher's book, because, you know, they did such an amazing bang-up job on it. But again, like I need another project right now. Like I need a home.
Yeah, Yeah, no, that's understood. And, you know, maybe this is something that happens after, you know, the third book in the trilogy comes out, and or, you know, maybe after, because you're going to do another grouping of books after this, correct?
There will be more stories in the world, absolutely. Yeah. And I will also say, you know, I've had very fond thoughts of doing a board game, because I know part of what people want is the ability to go in and play in my world, to like experience more time in my world even after they've read the books. And so I have some ideas for a board game that I think would be a lot of fun.
Nice.
Yeah. But again, I would need to put together a team for that, because what I want to do is a little strange. But I think I'm getting to know enough people that I could pull it off.
That's cool. That's very cool. You know, I think we've really covered I guess, you know, one last question. We'll try to make this sort of brief if possible.
I'll do my best.
when you're creating a world, and we've kind of loosely touched on this, but let's see if we can get to the heart of the matter here. When you're building a world, what are some guidelines that you would offer a storyteller? And I'm going to limit this just to RPGs, not writing a book, just an RPG. If somebody says, hey, I'm going to do a fantasy setting and I need some help. What I want to make this a rich world. I want to make it interesting, but I don't want to go insane trying to,
right,
to develop it. What tips would you give somebody? What clues would you give them?
I'm actually going to tie this to the response that I give people when they ask me about world building as story.
Okay.
There, what I say is everyone takes their lead from Tolkien, because Tolkien did it really amazingly well. That's, you know, he created a world that felt so rich that everyone was just like, wow, I didn't know you could do that.
Yeah.
And so they go, well, how did he do it? And they go, wow, he had like 14 different languages, and he had this rich history, and he did this and this. So they go, okay, so that must be what it takes to make a world. But that's not what happened. What happened is that Tolkien was a geek for like the Norse Eddas and mythology and language. And so those things that he was a geek for were an essential and inextricable part of the world and story that he created. In some ways, his world and his story were manifestations of his passions, which were linguistics, mythology, you know, and like this Norse history. And so I tell people, don't try to do what Tolkien did, because you're not Tolkien. Find out what you are really passionate about, and then let those passions inform your world. For me, it's like I'm a geek for currency and economy. I am really interested in human psychology. I'm really interested in folklore. I was almost a chemical engineer. I'm a geek for some of these scientific elements, and so you see that in elements of the magic.
Sure.
I'm interested in language, but in a different way from Tolkien, and so it manifests in a different way than Tolkien's does. I don't want to make a language. I want to use the language in the story itself. And so you actually see that more in the naming magic than anything else, some of my opinions about linguistics. I'm a dabbler in philosophy and some martial arts, and so you see a little bit of that in there. You do not see huge crashing armies. You don't see people talking a lot about clothes. You don't see a lot of things that show up in a lot of other fantasy books, because I don't get those things, and or I do not give a shit about them.
Sure.
Similarly, Tolkien did not care about the economy of Middle Earth. Like, nobody buys anything.
Yeah.
And that's not a failing of his word. You know, it's just, it doesn't fit in. Like, in the Eddas, you know, in the Ring of the Nibelungs, nobody stops by an inn and goes, oh, God, we have to sleep on the floor tonight because we don't have enough money. I guess we got to go kill some goblins and, like, get some gold pieces. And yeah. Oh, shit, no, that's not the story we're telling there. So to bring it into a role-playing world, you have to think, what sort of a story am I telling? And that I'm good at. You know, I say, and it's important, and here's the other half of it. You have to say, what sort of story are the characters looking to tell? Because they're your partners.
Yeah, yes, absolutely.
And that's where I fall down sometimes. I'm like, you know, like with Todd, when Todd runs a game, and Ian has summed this up very nicely once, he said, if you're playing in a pulp game of Todd's, you need to think, what would a hero do now? And then you do it.
Then you will
meet with success. So it's like, is there, you know, and I remember we were playing some World War II, you know, like 1920s pulp thing, and I was not familiar with the pulp genre, and I'm playing a mad scientist, and we've been captured, and we're on a Zeppelin, and we break out of the jail cell, and we're wandering through, and we go through the engine room, and I'm like, ah, yes, interesting, and then we walk through the engine room, and afterward, Todd is like, you're a mad scientist, and I put you on the Nazi Zeppelin.
Yes.
You go through the engine room, and you do not sabotage the engines of the Nazi Zeppelin? And I'm like, well, I don't want to crash. I'm in the Zeppelin. I don't want to crash it. Like, look, over the ocean, and I'll die. Because I was playing a different game than he was.
Yeah.
And so I didn't respond properly to that scenario. And so, like, if I'd been playing, like, Viari, you know, that is the swashbuckling hero, the one that I play for Acquisitions. He is more of a pulp hero. It's like, is there a chandelier? I am going to swing on that. Is there some unspeakable evil? I am going to jump on. I am into the fray. I will attack it. Because that's the sort of game that we're playing, and Chris Perkins will roll with it. What happens, my games are... Usually, the theme is, if Todd's is, who wants to be a hero? Or what makes a hero? Or what would a hero do? My games are kind of like my stories. It's like, what is really true? And if you it's a mystery. You're uncovering what's going on in the world. And as you learn that, you gain power in the world. And you're able to control events around you. And that's how you move forward in the story. You see that in my books, too. That's kind of a thing with me, is uncovering the true nature of the world. And so what's happened sometimes is I play games with Todd, and then the people from, and they're like, wow, Todd's game is awesome. Then they come to me, and they're like, I grab the chandelier, and I swing on it. And I'm like, geez, no, the chandelier is not designed for that.
Yes.
You know, you're living in a very realistic world here, and boy, it's an old building. You knew it was old. That's not. It falls on you, and I mean, you break your leg, and you, I mean, you don't have access to good medical care. I mean, this is the Middle Ages. I mean, yep. I'm sorry, it goes septic, and you're a cripple. You know, it's an issue of idiom, and so I would say when you're building this role playing world, think about what's the story that you're going to tell, and what story do the characters, not just the players, the characters want to be involved telling with you.
Yeah.
And so that means if there's going to be a lot of swashbuckling and a lot of fighting, you need to make monsters, fun monsters to fight.
Yeah.
The Harry Dresden books are full of these.
Yes.
And that's part of what's great. He writes great action sequences, and they're full of interesting monsters, and Harry can, like, throw all sorts of fucking fabulous magic all over the place, and it's a ton of fun. If you took my world and tried to do a Harry Dresden action sequence in it, see, it wouldn't work.
It doesn't fit. No, it doesn't fit at all.
It doesn't fit at all. In no more than if you tried to do the wire in Jim Butcher's book. You know, it just doesn't fit.
No, it doesn't.
No more than if you tried to do Twilight in my book. You know, or if Kvothe went to Hogwarts, it doesn't work.
No.
You know, Kvothe goes to Hogwarts and either just gets dead, or he becomes Voldemort, actually, because he's way too practical, and he's just going to tear everybody's shit apart.
Yeah. No, that's very true. And I think you hit the nail on the head with, in the past, I've really kind of talked more about the storytellers need to be in tune with the players, but conversely, you need to be in tune with the type of story that the strengths of the storyteller, whoever's running the game, knowing how they construct things, because you're very right. When Todd runs something, you do the heroic thing, and it might not be realistic, but you as a player trust and know how Todd runs the game, that is, he will take care of the details. What is important to him is the story and the outcome. The reality of the thing is not important. It's moving the story forward and having that incredible thing that you and he both know you or your character are looking for, but there's that partnership, that inherent trust that you have between each other, a sort of an unwritten pact, if you want to be dramatic about it, but you're in it together. And I think that's ultimately what happens with an RPG group, or should happen, I guess, more accurately, should happen with a group.
In a perfect world, it happens naturally. And with something like D&D, like, everybody reads the rule book, and you're like, okay, I'm going to hit monsters until candy comes out, I'm going to eat the candy and get fat, and I'm going to go kill bigger monsters. And you're like, we all on the same page here? Yeah. And you do it, and it is awesome, you know? And then you get a little bit of role-playing around the edges, you know, that kind of evolves naturally, but you know, ultimately, the core mechanic is, like, hitting monsters, eating candy. It's the same thing. It happens all the time in stories, where if you read Little Red Riding Hood, and we shift genre gears, this is ultimately genre.
Yeah.
We shift genre gears effortlessly in our minds as we move from story to story, because nobody picks up. You know, once upon a time there was a girl who had a little red hood. And she was going through the forest to bring her grandmother medicine and food because she was an old woman and lived alone. And then a wolf comes and talks to her, and nobody ever goes, whoa, 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 whoa. A wolf can't talk.
Yes. Yep.
This is a bullshit story. Things like this can't happen. Wolves can't talk. Nobody does that, because what happens is you read it and you go, okay, I am in this world. I am in folklore. And that means animals can talk, things are drawn with broad lines, and then you'd never get to the end of that story, and then the woodsman comes, and he cuts open the wolf, and the woman, and the old woman, and Little Red jump out of his belly, da-da, and everybody goes, whoa, 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 whoa. if you think of how big around a wolf's throat is, there's no way they could get into his belly and remain whole. That's simply, to say nothing of the fact that all animals chew their food, it doesn't work. You know?
That wolf is the world's worst masticator ever.
And so, like, we do this naturally with stories, and the problem is, in our games, if we are into games, it's because at one point we had a good group.
Yeah.
And what made that first group good is that they fit together and they were all pretty much doing the same thing. And that means, but what happens is some people, for them, their first group was, they were gamers, by which I mean, like, they played a module and they tore it apart. And they had the graph paper, and they were getting levels and, like, maximizing their treasure, and they were focused on their builds, and they had a great time. And then, for some people, their first game was Vampire. You know? For some people, their very first game was Traveler. And for some people, their very first game was Teenagers from Outer Space. Or maybe their very first game was a LARP.
Yeah.
And so they all have these good experiences and these good communal whatever. And so imagine taking a person from each of those and you sit them down at a table and they'll say, yeah, I'm a gamer. I know how to, I know what role playing is. And it is going to be a hot fucking mess.
Yeah. No, you're
because
right.
Because everyone thinks that they're playing a different game. Now there, at least it'll fall out very quickly that everyone is expecting something different. And I just highly recommend effectively foregrounding it with people. It's something that I never thought to do.
Yep.
I ran a game, not recently, but it's the most recent one that I ran, and I wish it was with Ian, and I wish I would have said to people, Todd's game is about what is it to be a hero. I go, my game is about uncovering the true secret turnings of how the world works. You know, there's... The theme of the game is true information is difficult to come by, but once you have it, you can truly control your own fate, and that's what makes you heroic. And they might have said, Jesus, that sounds fucking awful. And I go, in that case, it's all tits and chandeliers. And then we're like, woo! Yay, we want tits and chandeliers. I'm like, okay, let's run that instead.
I would play that game.
I think we've created two games here. We've got tits and chandeliers and what was it? Dungeon puppies and...
Cave puppies and dungeon butterflies.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, well, no, thank you very much for that. And the more that we have discussions like this, I really feel like when we had the episode with Ian and we kind of sat down and deconstructed morals in a game and, you know, if there was a mechanic for it, it operated this way, or, you know, if you came to the table and you all sort of created your own moral system that wasn't a mechanic in the game itself but was still a part of it because you created it together, it's fun deconstructing bits of gaming and trying to come up with truth of the thing, because it's not until you really understand something. And I think you could say that about writing. You could say it about anything. It's one thing to write. It's another thing to understand how good writing happens. It doesn't just happen. You need to master it. You need to know the angles and how a turn of a phrase can actually make or break a section of a story. You know, the more you can sit down and actually understand everything about the mechanic of a thing, it becomes reflexive. It happens because you've mastered it and you know it completely, and that's how you make a good thing.
It comes down to craft.
Yes.
You know, playing a character, there's a craft to it. And playing and running a game, there's absolutely a craft to it.
Yes.
I would say that I can't remember what I was going to say.
But I bet you it was amazing.
It was so. It was the best. Let's just all assume that it was brilliant.
I could work with that. Absolutely.
Should I talk about the mid-season fundraiser real quick?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Let's talk about that.
I'm just going to make my quick pitch here. It's running in the first week of June. It's World Builders. We raise money from the geek community. We do good things all over the world with it. A lot of the times through Heifer International, although we do other things too. We gave a bunch of money to First Book, which, as you might guess by the name, First Book gives a lot of underprivileged kids the opportunity to actually own books.
Nice.
Like, there's a horrifying statistic that says the in the, some of the poor parts of the country. Like, if you're middle class, the odds are you have 16 books in the house for every kid, which still seems horrifyingly low to me.
Yeah, it does.
In the, some of the poor areas of the country, there are 300 children for every one book.
Oh, God.
And First Book is fixing that. And so we gave a bunch of money to First Book because that shit is important. There's a bunch of, you know, the Syrian refugees this winter, things were bad, and they needed tents, and they needed blankets to stay warm. And so World Builders, somebody was offering a doubling match of money, and like, okay, you know, they need that right now. Let's do something about that. We gave them some money. Ultimately, we're about making the world a better place and doing it in the smartest, most sustainable, biggest bang for your buck way possible. Because we're geeks and we want to min-max everything we do.
Yes, absolutely.
What we have coming up is it's our mid-season fundraiser. We have a big shindig at the end of the year. Everyone's welcome to it. But this thing is different. It's a big Indiegogo where we collect things from the geek community and then we sell them and all the money goes to charity. So there's a bunch of stuff based on my books, you know, various merch things. We're doing, we've got t-shirts. We're doing some stuff with different authors. Vi Hart, the math musician, is going to be helping us out and providing some stuff. We've got, you know, we sell a yearly calendar that is similar to but legally distinct from Doctor Who themed. And that we're going to do, that was last year's, we're going to do this year's. It's your opportunity to pre-order that and have it be cheaper than it would be otherwise. There's a bunch of cool stuff. Len Peralta's Geek a Week decks, if you missed that Kickstarter, we are the only people that will be selling those decks because I stepped in and I bought a bunch in his Kickstarter. And he's agreed to help out World Builders by, you know, by making those available. We've got a ton of stuff. If you're any flavor of geek and you don't stop by to see what we've got, you're probably missing out on something you'd really like.
And where would they go to check all that stuff out?
You could probably find it. Again, this won't be up until the 1st of June. The first week of June. It's going to be on Indiegogo, Geeks Doing Good. Or if you want to find out about World Builders in general, worldbuilders.org.
Okay,
remember the org. If you go to worldbuilders.com, that's not us.
Yes, World Builders is an organization, so just think of that, worldbuilders.org. And the information for that Indiegogo should appear on worldbuilders.org, correct?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep, or all over my social media for that week. Stay tuned to the blog, stay tuned to Facebook and Twitter. We'll be making some noise about it.
Yes, and please follow Pat on Twitter and check out his blog because it's always entertaining as hell.
If it even is Pat.
You know, you're still not over that, are you?
That was a very interesting experiment. I applaud you for doing that because that was very funny, very funny. Let's see. Hello, my name is. We're going to get back to this here. Hello, my name is your opportunity to go to galacticnetcasts.com and find the adventure party on that site. And we have a link to Hello, my name is. And what you can do is you can go there and you can type in information about, brief information about yourself and a character that you really enjoyed playing and why that character was really awesome. And yes, we do ask for your email address. No, we do not spam you. The only purpose for the email address is we will email you a certificate saying that we talked about your character, and that's the whole point of this thing, is we will talk about you and your character and why it was so cool and why it's so fun to do RPG games, because this is something that we're passionate about and one of the main reasons why we created the adventure party. So give it a shot. Go to galacticnetcast.com and find the link there to enter the information for Hello, My Name Is, and we would love to talk about you and your character. Just want to thank you so much for taking the time, Pat, to come on the show and talk about world building and the craft of constructing good stories and good storytelling, and I really appreciate you doing that.
Well, you know, this has made me hungry to roleplay again. We should see if we can whistle Ian's ass up here, and if you come down and he comes up, and maybe we'll, I don't know, we should get four. Too many people and I freak out, but
yeah,
that would be fun.
I'm actually working on a thing. And I said I was going to mention it in a couple of episodes when Ian was on, and we are now, that was episode 5, this is episode 7, so I'm going to briefly talk about this. I keep talking about this game, Dirgewood, that I did, that was in the World of Darkness setting, where everybody is a vampire. I wasn't limiting it to vampires, but investigating the unknown, the supernatural. So it would be vampires, it would be werewolves, and this is a Wild West sort of era campaign, and we're going to be doing this using Roll20.net. So it would be virtually. So we'd be doing it through Google Hangouts, essentially. That's the core of their system. And it has a sort of a map layout, and you can share documents and whatnot, and it's a virtual thing. So we don't even need to be in the same room, the same house to do the game.
Hold on, I did that with the Mistclicks, I think. I think I used that Roll20, yeah.
And they've made...
Yeah, it worked out pretty well.
They've made some interesting improvements here in the past, like, 5 to 6 months. And I created an account, and I've really kind of been thinking about actually doing a supplement to Adventure Party, where we actually do a game, actually do an RPG and record that, and doing it in, you know, hour, 2 hour bites, and putting out the podcast. So it'd be a real play podcast, but it would be in addition to Adventure Party and getting people together and actually playing a game. I think that would be kind of fun, and if you are available, I would extend that invite to you, Pat, and if that works in your schedule, awesome. And
drop me a line. Okay. A lot will depend. I don't want to be the thorn in your side. I don't want to be that guy who can never make the gaming date so that he screws everything up. So,
no,
yeah.
And I think for you... I would not have a problem with, you know, if you can jump in and jump out, constructing your character as somebody that maybe does business abroad and isn't there all the time. So, I mean,
or,
I could
easily... Or maybe even I could come in and pinch hit NPCs for you or something.
Okay. Okay. Well, yeah, I will drop you a line. I don't have a date yet as to when I'm going to start that. I
get that.
I actually... And Onyx River... they actually did a 20th anniversary edition of The Hunters Hunted. The Hunters Hunted was a supplement book that White Wolf put out in 1992, which I have and is horribly dog-eared, and that's what I based Dirgewood on. And I just picked up their 20th anniversary edition, and the beauty of it is it actually collected a lot of supplemental things from other books that they put out and actually put in, like, Hedge Magic, but then they put in Numina, which are other supernatural skills and abilities that were either psi-based or telekinetic or, you know, different things. And they actually put it all in one book. And this is something that they kickstarted in 2013. So they did a 20th anniversary edition of that. And I shared the... Maybe I shouldn't say that out loud, but I shared the PDF of that with Ian, so he could take a look at it, and I'll open that up to you two, and I think I shared it with you too, Glenn, didn't I?
I don't think so.
Okay, well,
but I'm old and I forget things.
Well, I'm a jackass then. I will make sure that you get a link to that too. I will share it with you, and you can take a look at it at your leisure and see if that that interests you. And yeah, it would be a I haven't played a D10 game in a long time, because that's all White Wolf was D10s. So
I hear you.
I've been doing Pathfinder for so long that I've almost forgotten that different types of dice rolling, that was that was core. Everything you did was on a D10 for White Wolf. So
yeah.
I will send that your way, and you can take a look and see if that works. So
cool.
All right. You can go and find more out about Adventure Party by going to galacticnetcast.com. There you can find all of our social media outlets. We have a Facebook group page where everybody's invited to talk about sci-fi. Basically, Galactic Netcast is a group of people, and we put together podcasts that are sci-fi, news, gaming, obviously gaming stuff, and it's a collection of podcasts. You can check more out there at galacticnetcast.com, and we have a Facebook page, we have a YouTube channel, which if you're watching this, you know that, and you can always go to galacticnetcast.com and find out more about us. And if you're using iTunes or Stitcher, take a moment and give us a review and let us know what you think about the show. Is there something that we do really well, something that you that really kind of twigged with you that you really enjoyed and you want to follow up on and talk more about? That would be awesome. Please leave a review, positive or negative, and just let us know. That kind of helps shape the show into being something a little bit better. You can leave us feedback by emailing galacticnetcasts@gmail.com, or you can call or text 805-328-3966 and leave us a message. You can also go to galacticnetcasts.com, and we have a WordPress plugin where you can actually click an icon on the right side of the page, and if you have a microphone attached to your computer, you can leave us a voice message that way, and it just emails us, and we'll have that audio file, and we can highlight you on an upcoming episode. We did get some feedback, actually, on episode 5 with Ian Benton and Morals, Heroism, and Comfort in RPG Groups. And Gary True wrote us and said, cool stuff, thanks. Well, thank you for that, Gary. And Greg, I'm gonna butcher your name, and I apologize. Here in Wisconsin, if you have an EU, it can sometimes be an oi sound, or it can be an oo. But Greg, I'm gonna give it a try here. Greg Strouley, or Greg Strouley, or something like that, said, I can really see the change in the gaming store culture, which is also happening in comic shops, and especially now that I have kids that are approaching gaming age, I don't want to take my kids into a lewd store. And that's kind of going back to where we talked about some gaming shops and comic book shops being more of a clubhouse than an actual business, and not always being friendly to new people coming into the store. And you really don't... the stores that we really mentioned, that we really dug... people treat you well. You walk into the store and they acknowledge your existence, and they actually treat it like a business and not a clubhouse. So, yeah, if you can find stores like that, you know, definitely give them your cash, because they deserve to stay open. And clubhouses, not always the friendliest place to go and get your stuff. So, I want to thank everybody so much for listening to the Adventure Party. And as always, may your characters never die, and your adventures always be epic. Thank you very much, and good night.